crowd of people that are clothes mad, I suppose the word is, without being fashion mad. I don't mean fashion mad, but they're clothes mad.
We're going on to the trousers. Quite a low-fitting trouser, the mod trousers. These pockets are slanted frog mouth pockets. Frog mouth because the end of the pocket has a resemblance to a frog mouth. It causes the trousers to have a nice, clean, close-fitting line. Not forgetting the possibly inch and a quarter inch split at the bottom, or a step, depending on what type of shoe you were wearing. It was about attention to detail. That's your mod suit.
You'd often hang them at the end of your bed when you went to bed, and so you could wake up in the night and sort of see them, you know. You really love the clothes. Yeah.
You know, I have friends that used to put a handkerchief on their shoulder when they were giving a girl a goodnight kiss in case she got powder on their jacket. They were that bad.
In 1962, Town, the hippest magazine of the era, commissioned a piece about a little mob of mods from North London.
Wake up, you sleepy.
For a little while, we got a bit of a reputation of dressing differently to most other people. And we were approached, would we like to have some pictures taken? I think we were quite flattered, but on the other hand, we didn't show it. It wasn't cool to be shown.
Amongst the faces quoted was a mouthy 15-year-old called Mark Feld, who revealed his own style icon.
I read a good book the other day, The Life of Beau Brummel. What are we coming to? He was just like us, really. You know, he came up from nothing. I mean, I'm all for anyone who's a bit exhibitionist. You just don't want to be like everyone else. You've got to be different.
Mark was kind of like a hanger-oner with us. We were older than him. I think I must have been about 18 months older than him.
That young wannabe would become Mark Bolan, tripped-out troubadour of British rock. In 1962, he was just an apprentice mod.
That's my shirt. That shirt I got from a guy called Flash. The penny round collars from John Stevens, Bill Gorey's suit, Bill Gorey jackets, John Stevens' leather waistcoat. We didn't really let on where we got the clothes from because it was not cool to let people know. It was almost like an entry into our world.
About four shops only where you could buy stuff, whereas now there's so much. You know, if you want something that usually the designers create it and it's given out, whereas this was all very much you doing it, adapting it from a picture you saw.
I think it was an elitist, an unselfconsciously elitist thing. There was no cruelty in it. But you were elitist in the sense that you felt you'd hit on something that only a few people had hit on.
We weren't cruel. Yes, we were. We were cruel. We did look down on people that didn't have the ideas. If somebody didn't dress the right way, it would be better that someone didn't try to compete with us. We had more respect for them.
In all their narcissistic splendour, the original mods were the true heirs of Beau Brummel, the original face. Mod moved the world of British style, and everything was touched by the hand of mod. Movies were mod. Models were mod. Music was mod. Mod was up all night in downtown clubs. It was sweaty. Mods didn't do sweat, so they reached for a British label that has become part of street style history.
Over now to Hurlingham for a look at the latest fashions in sportswear. Fred Perry, more or less retired as a professional from tournament tennis, although still a brilliant coach, is rapidly gaining a name in another competitive sphere, as a sportswear designer. Meet lovely actress Vera Day, wearing a simple blouse and skirt that never have to be ironed. You just hang them up to dry.
It started as a tennis shirt, and was worn as a tennis shirt, and was stylish wear on the tennis court.
The Fred Perry shirt was stylish and sensible. The fabric breathed, making tennis a less unpleasantly moist leisure pursuit. And that was also why Mod loved Fred. You could dance all night and stay Mod cool.
So it went into the street. And I always think of it as being one of the very, very first crossover brands between sport and fashion or style or street anyway. So it stopped being worn for tennis, started being worn for what would have been early club wear.
Fred Perry is a fashion brand with a music and sportswear heritage. On a basic level, it's a tipped polo shirt with a laurel on the chest. It's a certain fit, it's a certain styling details, obviously. It's also a kind of reference, I guess, to our mod roots within the brand. The attention to detail, the attention to fabrication, the attention to fit. We're very lucky in the fact that Fred Perry has 50-odd years that we can refer back to, and so we can kind of plunder that archive and look at kind of contemporary fashion and reverse it back into our heritage to create a contemporary fashion garment. The brand itself, you'd argue, is certainly one of the most iconic that Britain has ever produced. It's kind of fundamental, really, without a doubt. And if you look at the kind of the brand's values and associations wrapped around the brand, kind of Britishness is kind of top of the list.
Liberated by Mod, Fred Perry would never leave the wardrobe of street looks. There was another item that was desired by devotees of 60s street style. And once more, it was pilfered from a classy source.
The button-down collar, as we see here, was actually invented by the company Brooks Brothers in America. They were watching... They used to play a lot of polo, and the collars on the shirts, as the players rode on the horses, would flap up their mouths and divert them. So somebody got this bright idea to put two buttons there to keep the collar down, and that's where the button-down shirt first originated.
They were an iconic object that transported you to a world that was out of your reach. It's like £4, but you had to have it, you know, you had to have it. It was really important.
To get the button-down then, the American button-down, cost you an arm and a leg, it really did. The solution to that problem was provided by a guy called Ben Sherman, who we see up here. And Ben thought to himself, you know what, if you did these shirts, like with a candy stripe like this, or a tartan, or a kitchen tablecloth, as I call them, another tartan there, they would really sell. And he started producing these shirts, designed for young people, for young men. So this is the collar and the three finger rule. Any collar that you can't get three fingers into, not really worth it.
Ben Sherman was a British designer who realized the country was about to be hit with a lust for neatness. But wasn't this the era of going to California to hang loose?
It's funny. When I read about the 1960s, everyone says it was hippies and the summer of love and long hair. Well, not round here it weren't. And not in thousands of council estates like this it wasn't.
I can remember the hippies big time, in the Afghan coats and the bells around their neck and stuff like that. But it weren't our cup of tea. I think that you was proud to be English